Good evening, everyone. Hello. Hi. Welcome to LA Louver. I'm Lisa Jan. I'm the managing director of the gallery. It's our great pleasure to welcome you here all tonight. On behalf of my colleagues, it is such a wonderful thing that you can join us for this very special evening, this conversation between Los Angeles artist Gajin Fujita and the cultural historian Josh Kun. We have the great privilege to be in this very room, surrounded by paintings that Gajin created over the last 3 years. The works in true colors, Gajin's sixth solo exhibition here at LA Louver, comprise a kind of visual diary of the artist's experience through the pandemic and to the present. These paintings describe in figure, form, and symbolism aspects of Gajin's interior life as it traversed emotional, political, and personal realms during this dynamic period. Tonight, we're excited to bring together Gajin and Josh once again for a meeting of minds as they connect and riff on Los Angeles identity, history, culture, and music. However, before I formally introduce Gajin and Josh, I'd like to acknowledge my extraordinary colleagues at LA Louver for working with such dedication and care to orchestrate this exhibition as well as the program tonight, including our founding director, Peter Gultz. Our director, please, give it up. Our directors, Kimberly Davis and Elizabeth East. And our extraordinary colleagues, Mimi King, Marie Derrick, Lydia Egan, Lauren Graber, Matthew Emmonson, Andrew Roth, Tom Pekovich, Lawrence Lee, and Chris Pate. We do it as a team, and for that, we're always grateful. And I'd also like to thank Gajin's wife, Angie, for all the things that she does. One more bit of housekeeping. If you're interested in acquiring a copy of the gorgeous True Colors catalog, books can be purchased at the front desk with my colleagues, Marie and Lydia. And there's also a special limited edition version of the publication that is accompanied by a beautiful print titled Queen of the Angels and signed and numbered by the artist. Please feel to approach any of us with any questions about the show or the publications. We're happy to be of assistance. And now on to the main event, and without further ado, introductions. Gajin Fujita received his BFA from Otis College of Art and Design, followed by an MFA from the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, where he studied with the esteemed art critic Dave Hickey. Fujita first established himself on the streets of Los Angeles with the graffiti crews KGB and K2S, but his earliest aesthetic influences were informed by his father, who was a painter, and his mother, a conservator of Japanese antiques. Fujita's work has been exhibited extensively and can be found in the permanent collections at LACMA, the Hammer Museum, Art Gallery of New South Wales, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Toledo Museum of Art, Blanton Museum, and the Kemper, among many others. And Josh Kun is a cultural historian, curator, and MacArthur Fellow. He is currently professor and the chair in cross-cultural communication at the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism at USC, where he also serves as the interim dean for the Thornton School of Music. He is the author and editor of numerous books, including the autograph book of LA, Improvements Upon the Page of City, which included the work of Gajin, and he is currently finishing his next book, Beats Across Borders, a Migrant Songbook. Please welcome Josh Kun and Gajin Fujita.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. How are we? Good. Thank you for joining us. Look at all the people who come for you. It's beautiful.
Thanks, everybody.
They all live like around the block, though. They didn't come far.
It seems like it.
Yeah. We're going to come back to this in a second, but in the spirit of a very important idea for you that we will return to, the idea of the roll call, I wanted to shout out, and we've heard some shout outs and some names that have been referenced already, but one is kind of what connects us, which is Ozomatli. Yes. So I wanted to name Ozomatli, any Ozomatli folk, any fans in the house? All right. Because that's actually where we never met, but we first worked together 13 years ago through a project I did with Ozo, and you were kind enough to do the logo for it, and we never met until years later.
Yeah. We met, when was that, like before the pandemic?
Before the pandemic, as part of the Autograph Book of LA project with the LA Public Library. Yep.
Right.
Yeah, well, we'll get into that. But pleasure to be with you again. honor to talk with you. So I wanted to start. Lisa mentioned the incredible catalog, which hopefully you've been able to check out. And if you haven't, I do really urge you to, if not pick up a copy, at least take a slow read through it, because it's really beautiful, great text. But when I opened it, I was actually really struck by something, which is the first thing you see in that catalog is not one of your works. The first thing you see is you at work. And it's you, you can fill in the details, but on your deck, a deck outside of your home in Echo Park.
Yes.
With views of downtown LA at dusk.
Yes.
Palm trees, purple and pink LA sky.
Yep.
Why did you want to start with that image?
That's a good question.
That's why I'm here, Gajin.
It was a decision made between the book designer and myself. People normally don't get to see artists at work. And I think that's where a lot of intrigue lies for the viewer of how an artist works and does his work and even the space he works in. So I thought that was appropriate beginning image and picture. And also the sunset and downtown, because I feel I'm rooted in the city of LA, and the sunset is spectacular every night. Nature comes to you with the most beautiful art, and I had to take advantage of the colors of the sunset,
I mean, it's really that idea that you're rooted in the city, right? Which for anyone who knows your work knows you're rooted in the city, and we see it in your own paintings. But I was just really struck with the extent to which in that framing of you, where you're small and the work that you're working on is small, you're actually not at the center of the photograph. The center of the photograph is the city around you.
Yeah.
And that LA is the work in a lot of ways, and you're a part of it.
Right. I think I'm just, a part of it, just like you and I and everybody else in this room. Yeah.
When you're out on that deck making work, at night, especially at dusk, what are you hearing?
Oh, man. All kinds of stuff. Mostly conflict. because the
like this, you mean?
Yeah, that's a huge conflict. But when you take a closer listen to things, I hear conflict at all levels of life, and it's within nature. Of course, you hear the white noise, with all the traffic and commotion, and it comes in waves as people get busy. It's like literally like a bloodline of life moving around. Morning time, there's traffic on the streets. Evening, there's traffic. So at dusk, you'll hear I'll hear sirens, helicopters. But then if I listen carefully enough, I'll hear like the animals going at it with each other. The raccoons start coming out at night. They're all kind of fighting for not only territory, but for food, resources. And I was just amazed to see how even like hummingbirds have like a hierarchy and which bird gets to suck on nectar, you know. They're constantly at kind of not at war, but they're fighting each other for the resources.
And you see that in your work, right? I mean, your work, especially this new work, is full of those conflicts in general, mm-hmm. but also specifically visualizations of those sounds.
Yes.
I mean, you've got some of the animals, you've got police helicopters.
So, yeah, I mean, the first painting, so this is a, in this gallery space is 3 years worth of work. And it was all made during the pandemic. So the first painting that I had made is called No Man's Land, and we were talking about it earlier. It's way up there in the corner there. I made right before the pandemic was like officially called around the world, and so even then I was listening to all this conflict. Yeah. And it just, and more throughout the pandemic, I realized how, you know, the conflict stems within all life, and mostly with us human beings. And so there's paintings that I painted about sort of the civil unrest that our country was facing. And there's just a lot, I think, and I feel that need to be exercised and taken care of.
Yeah, I mean, I wanted to start by referencing that just because, you know, music and sound are important to you, they're important to me, and I think it's always interesting to think about visual art, not only in terms of what you see, but in terms of the kind of sonic auditory presence that can be embedded within a canvas, embedded in a, you know, in a wood panel, embedded in paint. And that opening photograph was so rich in sound for me, even though it's totally silent.
Thanks. Yeah. I mean, once again, credit to my wife, Angela. She took that picture.
It's a great picture. Great. So we are about the same age.
Yes.
I'm 1 year older than you. Both grew up here in LA, different parts of the city. Tell me about your LA.
Tell me about
about the LA you grew up in.
Well, it's kind of tough because I grew up in Boyle Heights, where it is majority Latino, Chicanos, and my brother and I and a few other like Japanese Americans were the only like Asian kids that went to like the local elementary school. So we were being picked on, teased like on a daily basis. So it was pretty rough. I didn't realize why I was being picked on. I was just a child. So I feel as if I grew up really fast. But it was, I don't know, I guess it was just normal to me. I didn't know anything else, you know. But within the community, everybody, after once people realized that we were there to stay, they all kind of accepted us. And it was very, I don't know if communal is the right word, but they took us in like family. So like during Christmas, they would ask us over for tamales. And like it would be competitive because each and every, you know, family would be like, you're going to come over to our house, right? Like next and taste our tamales. Like, but
It was fun. I feel like I had a normal sort of growing up in the city. And then I didn't realize till I finally got off the block and started middle school in mid-city is when I realized how diverse and how large our city is here in LA. And then I started seeing different cultures. And that, I think that was the one good thing about the magnet schools that LAUSD had, because it brought together many kids, many students from all walks of life. And so what I went to LACES, LACES, and it used to be on Pico and Arlington. And that was the, you know, when I started there, junior high, seventh grade, that was the very first time, like, I saw black street gangs. Until then, I only knew of, or, you know, black gangs through movies or through TV. And it was fascinating. And then you get to, so I was in class with, like, students from all different classes. You know, there were kids from the Palisades, there were kids from South Central, there were kids from Hollywood, and myself from East LA, Boyle Heights. And that was an eye-awakening sort of moment.
I mean, it's interesting because those, particularly Boyle Heights, is, you know, the history, obviously, of that neighborhood is one for a large chunk of the 20th century, is a neighborhood of coalition and multicultural communities, Japanese American, Jewish American, Latino. Yeah. And then really post-World War II becomes much more a kind of distinctly and then eventually almost exclusively Mexican American neighborhood.
Yes.
And really is a kind of model of the different modes of LA life, of like cross-cultural exchange and also fighting over resources.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It definitely is. I wish there was more unity, though. I still see there's segregation in the city for sure, and I think it deals with like the classes, because I would really trip out when I would jump on the RTD or the Metro and, like, for instance, take the Sunset bus. Well, I think it was the 4 line. Starting from, like, the Union Station, right around Chinatown, Alvarez Street, and it'll take you all the way to the beach. And you can see just the class sort of changing, you know, from like, you know, a ghetto area to an affluent area. And, you know, I learned a lot just jumping on the buses, you know.
I mean, so much of that is about a kind of meeting of worlds, or something that I think we'll come back to in a little bit, that this work technically has, which is a layering, like a lot of layering,
yes,
not just of materials, but a layering of worlds. And so back in your training, in the introduction, Lisa mentioned you're training at Otis, UNLV, where, among other things, you studied Asian art history, but there was also the education on the streets, right? Art education, is that fair or no?
Yeah, no, I mean, that's more than fair, because graffiti is something that, you know, you don't learn at school. you just got to go out and do it.
I feel like now they're teaching it.
Yeah, now they're teaching it, but like when you know, back in the 80s when I was...
Now it's practicing. A very expensive master's program.
Well,
good luck for those who are trying to teach it. I know that there's like tutorial videos now on like YouTube and stuff.
How to be an authentic craft artist.
I feel like it was also when you're doing graffiti out in the streets, it's a pure form of art because you're out there doing it for free, or you're trying to get up. It's very competitive where you're trying to write your name as many times as possible all throughout the city, so you can go all city, what the kids say. You're kind of risking your freedom because you could get caught and spend time in jail and stuff like that. I feel it is like a very spirited and true form of art.
One of the ways that I tend to look at the city in particular is through the metaphor, but really the practice of a crossfader on a DJ mixer. Mm-hmm. You know, where you can have like one track on the first input, another track on, they're totally separate track on the second input. And then the crossfader is what allows you to juggle those inputs. Would it be fair to say that kind of your interest in and dedication to 17th and 18th and 19th century Japanese art from the Edo period was on input one, and then you had graffiti on input two, and you're kind of toggling
fading
back and forth?
Yeah, yeah, no. Sometimes when I'm painting these paintings, I feel like I'm like a music producer where I'm putting together, just like you said, on the crossfader or the mixer, these different layers that I've grabbed and sampled. It's very fair to say that, yeah.
A big part of graffiti culture and LA graffiti culture in particular is this idea that I referenced at the top of the roll call. You did an exhibition here several years ago called Roll Call.
Yeah, that was 2016.
And in the back of the new catalog, it ends with a roll call.
Yes.
Could you talk about, for those who don't know, what the roll call is, and particularly with the catalog, why those names?
So, with the catalog, those names are of the artists that, it's basically a roll call list of artists that had a hand in working on the painting and collaborating with me. And I also listed some of these people, some of my good friends that have passed away during the pandemic as well. So it's like a dedication piece, or dedication page, I should say. And roll call is very important in when we're out in the streets as graffiti artists, and we would go up to a yard as a crew. Each and everyone has a role to either fill in or to work on the painting, on the piece. And at the end, everybody would write their names, or there would be a roll call, a list of artists that had worked on the painting. And so that's how I was looking at that page, the roll call page.
And just, we could maybe even use this painting as an example of that, right? Could you point out, because this is not all, these tags are not you.
No, so with the tagging, and the graffiti, I was trying to bring the street into my studio. Because there's always a question of, you see these graffiti tags and graffiti mark making in the setting of a gallery like this. Is it become graffiti now, or is it Is it still graffiti, or is it not graffiti? And it's a good question, but I've always wanted to bring elements of the street into the studio and try to harness and capture that sort of act. So I'll have the taggers kind of just randomly tag wherever they want, just how it would be out in the streets. And that's what I'm trying to recreate.
Could you call out a few folks?
Sure. So this sort of very calligraphic writing is done by my good friend Deffer, who's also another Japanese American who grew up with me in Boyle Heights. And there's Prime, Ryo. I had an old friend, Doom. He came by. Take. There's. I put up Amos and Jack. Rest in peace. Helper. Gabe. So,
yeah. I mean, one of the things that's so interesting, particularly about the kind of 1980s, 1990s graffiti world, is that it was so operated through crews, right?
Yeah.
So on the one hand, you had collective tags. So your crews, you know, K2S and KGB.
Yeah.
But then you also had individual tags.
Mm-hmm.
And I just love that, particularly in the contemporary art world, which is so individualistic, that you keep the crew. Like you see KGB, I'm staring right at KGB right there.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about that relationship between you as an individual artist and the crew?
I mean,
is there ever beef? Are they like, no, your crew, you can't be.
You know, so I mean, as I've gotten older, it's kind of childish to be beefing like that, but.
It's amazing how that happens, isn't it?
But people do get hurt sometimes, you know, like, why didn't you invite me, or, but I just feel that it's an integral part, the crew is like an integral part of my life and the works that I make, and, you know, if I do good, I think the crew's gonna look good. And that's how I feel.
And you actually had the crew here for an event, right? Like a while ago with Warren G, and I saw, I wasn't there. I didn't get invited.
Oh, no, no.
That's cool though, Gajin.
I'm sorry.
Not to be
sorry,
childish.
Josh. Sorry, Josh. Well, you didn't have a ticket?
That's right.
No, that wasn't here. That
wasn't here. Okay.
That was the, gosh, it was off of Wilshire.
Okay.
In front of LACMA.
Got it.
And my crew members from KGB, they know some people, and they knew Warren G, so he came. It was a 30-year reunion show of the KGB crew. KGB stands for, it initially stood for Kings of Graffiti Bombing, but now we just use Kids Gone Bad.
Yeah. Which is like dangerously close to a boy band. That close.
But, yeah. But yeah, so the crew, I just feel like it's a fraternity. And I feel so honored and privileged to know some of these artists that I kind of grew up with and had this surrogate family.
One of the things when we worked together a bit on the Autograph Book of LA project with LA Public Library, which is based on an actual collection of autographs that the LA Public Library has in their special collections. And the whole project was about this idea of writing on the city, about leaving your mark in one way or another, and about memory and the politics of memory, and whose names get remembered.
Yeah.
And whose names are forgotten. And we talked a lot about graffiti as a really important part of that negotiation of memory in LA. Mm-hmm. Where going up, going all city, getting your name on a, you know, on the right overpass on the 110
billboards,
north, hypothetically.
Yeah.
Is like prime real estate for memory, right? So that you're not forgotten. And so much of the work that the public library does is about that. And you, of course, beautifully were able to create a library card. What, 4 years ago now?
Yes.
5 years ago? Everybody mm-hmm. have their LAPL card. I mean, what was that like for you to be able to kind of go up on a library card?
That was the ultimate get up. Yeah. I went all city overnight. But no, that was a feeling of elation, and I was very honored to do that, and it felt great that a place like the library is recognizing art and championing it.
So when, I'd say in the past, when your work is written about, it is often talked about as kind of your references to, as I mentioned before, 17th, 18th, 19th century art in Japan and LA. And when I was looking at this newer work mm-hmm. in particular, particularly the WTF piece right there, mm-hmm. and the Sup, Do We Have a Problem piece, mm-hmm. Both of those struck me, which feature geishas mm-hmm. And quote-unquote Japanese art, but they really struck me as Japanese-American LA pieces, where they weren't separate worlds at all. Again, they were together, and really felt like kind of migrant pieces or immigrant pieces in some way. And I realize I've never asked you specifically about the immigrant
part.
Piece of mm-hmm. your visual vocabulary. Like, is that something you think about?
The immigrant piece, huh?
Think about your parents' story, for example.
Yeah. I never really had asked my parents what they felt or what it was like for them to immigrate to the United States. I guess I just never bothered. And now it's, I can't ask them because my dad's gone, been gone, and then my mom's afflicted with Alzheimer's, so she can't remember shit. But you know, I don't think about the immigrant part as much. Maybe because I was born here and raised here. Just to be fair, I don't. Yeah. You know, the collision of the two cultures, though, growing up in Hollywood in LA, like the movie Blade Runner was a huge movie, and or when like the Wu-Tang Clan started using Kung Fu movie audio bites and samurai movie audio bites, I just thought, well, if they can do it, I can do it as well. And that's where the collision, I think, had started.
Yeah, I mean, in the Sup, Do We Have a Problem, uh-huh. right? It's a geisha with a Glock.
Yeah, it's a right? geisha with a shotgun.
With a
yes.
shotgun.
Yeah.
And then you've got, you know, in this piece, in WTF, you've got her on the...
A cell phone.
taking a selfie on a bus bench
yes.
that says pandemic on it.
Yep.
With a bit of the Hollywood sign.
Yep.
with a burning palm tree.
Yeah.
And you know, that also reminded me very much back to Day of the Locust, shout out our LA class, where, you know, in the novel Day of the Locust from the 30s, the main character is working on a painting called The Burning of Los Angeles, where he's imagining LA on fire. And that just felt to me like oddly, like your most LA piece that I'd seen in some ways, in
Thank
terms of
you.
The traditional visual and literary history of the city.
Well, thanks, thanks. I mean, that's what I was going after for sure. And it's also having to have lived through the 92 riots, the last time I had seen, well, previous to what had happened in 2020, but what had happened in 2020 wasn't just LA, it was all over the country. Yeah. And, you know, I had never, I don't think I would have ever imagined such a thing happening in our country. And I just felt that the tension is like right on the cusp of just breaking and all hell breaking loose. And so, I went to work on that painting.
So you mentioned 92.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that prophesied 92 was hip hop. You came up within the rise of hip hop.
Yeah.
You and I both, we are of that generation, grew up with it.
Yeah.
Could you talk about your relationship to hip hop in those early days? We're celebrating the 50th anniversary of hip hop in August of this year. Technically the very first hip-hop party, August 11th in the South Bronx. And hip-hop makes its way from the South Bronx to L.A. a little bit later, in the early 80s. But yeah, can you talk about the influence of hip-hop on you?
Sure. I mean, like, so, you know, I think hip-hop was happening, like, way early out, like, in New York City and stuff. And we were kind of on the late tip out here in the West Coast. Not to say, though, that there was all kinds of graffiti and stuff going on before that. It was mostly street gangs and stuff out here. But, you know, my influence comes from, during the summer, or I think we were still, so I was already at Laces in junior high, so it was like 84, 85. And up until then, I think we were, well, at least in my neighborhood, I was like listening to rock music, heavy metal and stuff, Ozzy Osbourne, Black Sabbath, and all that good stuff. But then, I think you and I both saw the transitioning of this culture that took all of us by storm, basically. And I was so fascinated, but by not only like hip hop had so many different elements to it. It wasn't just graffiti. It wasn't just rhyming. There was breakdancing. That you had the B-boys. You had MCing. You had the DJing, there were so many components, and what was very attractive about it was competitive, but yet it wasn't like the street gangs where you were gonna kill each other. You know, you got to come back the next day, improve yourself. And that's what was very attractive to me, where you get to compete, but you also get to keep your life and you get to practice and hone in on getting better at what you're doing. And then, so I really like the visual aspects of like doing graffiti and also kind of an act of mischief where you know, you're gonna get away with something. in being a vandal. And so, yeah, I would, you know, try to stay over at my friend's house because they were going to air Style Wars on KCET. So we would be waiting for hours for them to come out. Because it was, you know, there wasn't no YouTube or nothing like that back then. So that was also the other thing about when I was being influenced by hip hop was technology was like little to nothing. You know, we had the rotary phone, and wherever we commuted was on the bus. So things were like information was being communicated very slowly. So some of like the graffiti pieces that stood out to me back then, you had to kind of go there and see it for yourself, and you were the judge for yourself to see how what everyone was talking about. So those are kind of the times that I grew up in.
I mean, we should confess to these kind people who come to see us that the only prep we did was really just emailing back and forth about like favorite hip hop tracks that influenced you. And I wanted to actually maybe play one of them. You put together a great playlist. Maybe can we hear my melody?
Oh, wow. Check out my melody.
There we go. So, like we made it, yeah.
Hey, you, Eric, and I'm Rock.
Yeah, exactly. I like that you chose Rakim. That was smooth. That was really good.
Of course, yeah. I had to do.
So, like, could you talk about a track like this? Like, what do you hear? What does it take?
Oh
you
my
back
gosh!
To?
It's
how does
like,
it relate to this work?
You know, I don't know if it relates directly to the work, but it was a huge influence to me. I think Eric B. and Rakim dropped this album, Paid in Full, 1986. So that's when, we were all listening to Walkmans and, like, had headphones on. And, like, so on the school bus ride every day to school, that's all I would be playing is Eric B. and Rakim, because it was like they introduced the bass thumping and like and it was Rakim was like a lyricist. He was talking about the neighborhood where he grew up in, and that was what we, not only myself, but we were all intrigued by that, like what was it like for them. And yeah, they put together a dope ass album. Yeah.
Well, it's a great playlist you put together.
Oh no, there's a lot of people missing, but yeah.
And also what I thought was interesting that I don't know if folks know is actually one of the earliest documentaries on LA hip hop, you co-directed, co-produced LA Hip Hop Volume 1.
I did.
In 97.
By virtue of just, it was like an accident. Yeah.
It's on YouTube. There are excerpts of it are on YouTube.
But Alan Nakagawa was responsible for that.
Worth checking out, though. Okay, so I want to talk about just a couple more questions and we'll open it up, but I want to talk about some of the materials in these pieces.
Uh-huh.
Specifically, so let me list off a few things. Spray paint, paper cut stencils, mean streak markers, Sakura streak markers, metalhead markers, and then the iPhone. One of the things I loved in the catalog are the shots of you at work on that deck, working on pieces, often with an iPhone, with a photographic image that you are riffing off of. Could you talk about like when the iPhone entered, like when did it become part of your toolbox?
Well, I don't remember the exact date, but...
next time, all right? Get it together.
I have to remind myself next time. But I did start using a lot of my iPhone in the making of a lot of these paintings in this space right now, especially with the portraits, mm-hmm. portraits of my mom, portrait of Tommy. I just figured, the phone's become such a tool, not only visually, but for communication and everything else. I felt that I should take advantage of it. Yeah. And it, you know, I want to make my life easier, not harder. So it was within these 3 years that I've really started using the phone. Because I'm especially doing during making the portraits, I'm constantly looking at the phone to see the color tones and you know, try to see the shading in their faces and in the figure.
There's a photograph in the catalog of you working with your mother writing next to you. And this is such an incredible portrait that you've created.
Oh, thanks.
Could you share a little bit about what that experience was like for you doing a portrait of your mom, particularly at this moment in your relationship?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like during the pandemic and all these 3 years, so this painting of my mom is called Forget Me Not, Chitose Fujita, and it's been tough for my brothers and I, because she has been afflicted with Alzheimer's and dementia, and you know, I felt compelled to do a painting of her, just because I felt that, you know, I didn't want my mom to forget us, and you know, I always wanted to see her her big smile, but I felt, you know, during the pandemic, and it probably happened to a lot of people where I felt her disease had worsened somehow. I think she had caught COVID a couple times as well. There were some incidents where she, you know, there were some scary incidents where she had left the house one time, and the CHP found her on the freeway, and actually, this picture that I took on my iPhone is of my mom at my house. Kind of near my studio, and she was holding a hibiscus flower. But it was that image that I sent to my friend Prime when she was missing last year, July 31st. And so I just felt, wow, it's like a reminder, you know, and how life is just fleeting.
I know it doesn't feel like it, but what a what a gift to have this, to be able to make this piece.
Thanks. I mean,
it's an extraordinary thing.
Thanks.
Maybe the last question I'll ask you is, in reading through the catalog, which I thought was really interesting, was also a mention back to materials about, and please correct me if I get this wrong, a new advancement in the paints that you were using that allowed for more translucency.
Yes.
To create different visual layers. And I was really struck with that, both at the level purely of materials and aesthetics, but about that as a kind of working metaphor in all your pieces, which is you see LA in layers, that it's not one thing that covers up and erases something. In looking at these pieces, you know, if you look at that piece, you've got, you know, mention, you know, the Boyle Heights street, but mm-hmm. you've also got a self-portrait. You've got different bits of history in your mother's painting. We've got Dumbo, the hibiscus flower. There's all these layers happening. Could you just talk about, like, that paint, like what that translucency does for you as a painter?
Well, that translucent paint in particular helped me, you know, maybe when I got... when I had first reconnected with my wife, that was like 8 years ago, she started to kind of suggest to me that maybe I should start, instead of using bold black outlining, to maybe use the same tone color of the of whatever that is filled in with. And then from there, I also heard in this very space, David Hockney talk about his work that was showing here. And he mentioned Eastern and Western art and how they differed. And he mentioned how Eastern art, like the woodblock prints that I was referencing, tend to be flat, are always 2D, very graphic, and have no shadows. In Western art, you would have, you know, I'm sure he was talking about like the Renaissance artists, you would see figures with shading and shadow, so they look more dimensional. They look kind of real to life. And that's where I thought, well, maybe I can, you know, kind of transpose these woodblock print images into having more dimension. And the spray paint companies today are now so amazing because they have so many colors in the color palette. And now they've come up with translucent paint and translucent black. You see, I use a lot, especially like in the portraits and in hashtag WTF, but it makes it so much easier to get the shade, like the shading and the dimensional qualities to the figures. The layering, your question. I do see LA like a layer, and I feel I've been working with layering to find dimension in space, perspectives and angles. That's where I'm sort of trying to get at with the layering.
I mean, when I look at it from that lens, your work, among many other artists, but your work is part of a story of pushing back against what Norman Klein wrote about years ago as the kind of LA's obsession with amnesia, right? Of forgetting and burying and covering up, of refusing to acknowledge layers.
Uh-huh.
And your work, you know, I think these pieces bring those layers up. And I was working on a project a few years ago with a photographer, and we were talking about this idea of simultaneity, that all these things happen at the same time in LA. And I just love that your work gives us the layers, the simultaneous experiences of difference across the city of LA that can connect to Japan, to Boyle Heights, to Venice, and none of them have to be erased. Like with the crossfader, you juggle the beats and you create new mixes, so.
Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Thank you for putting it so kindly. Yeah.
So, we take a couple questions? Yeah. So, we have time for maybe a couple questions, if people have them. We're going to emphasize the question part, right?
I think so.
Yeah. If you have a great speech you want to give, email it to Gajin.
No.
Don't do that. Speaking about layering, one of the things that I too look at graffiti all the time and fascinated by it and look at layering and think of my city as being full of layers, but one of those layers is often a buff. And I'm kind of curious about how you feel about that and if you've introduced that into your work, you know, of erasure and how it makes its own design.
So that part, I think, I feel comes when when I go over some of these tags that are tagged simultaneously and randomly. Some of the graffiti artists that I invite to my studio to do these tags, they're not sure if their tags are gonna last. So the buffing happens, but with my painting over their tags. So there are some hidden layers in the paintings.
Do we have another question? If not, thank you so much to Josh Kun and Gajin Fujita and to all of you for coming out tonight. And thank you so much. Really appreciate it.